so. Now you guys have had the chance to create several resources. An occurrence resource, taxonomic resource, metadata only resource. You've got several resources inside your IPG. And they're either in private state or they're public. I worked with a few of you to make your data public and showed you what that looks like. Has everybody seen what a public resource looks like? All right, I'm going to give you a quick little demo of what that looks like. Priscilla and I, she's my star student for the day, I think. We did the resource. Here's Priscilla's checklist. And so this is publicly available on the web because we changed the visibility from private to public. Okay? And you can see the name of the resource. You can see the description. Contacts. I actually get credit for this resource, which I'm happy about. And most of this was generated from the spreadsheet template, as we know. But this is on the internet, but how does somebody discover it? Maybe. Maybe they come to Google. That's one way. But another is, it's coming to the GBIF registry. So a global registry of all biodiversity data sets in the world. At least that's the goal. Come to the data portal. So let's do a quick demo of existing registered resources for Cameroon that we know about in the world. So I'm not going to go to Google, I'm going to go to the registry, because the registry knows about all registered resources. Let's try Cameroon. What does the registry know about datasets in Cameroon? Okay, so we've got a few. That's great. We've got one from the Cameroon National Herbarium, Freshwater Plants of Cameroon, and this one, IITA, Cameroon Insect. That's really cool, okay? Let's take this one. So, you can see that it's got a URL where I can access the resource, and it's being served by an IPT in Cameroon. Okay, enough of that. What about in the global data portal? What do we have for Cameroon in here? Well, ideally everything that gets registered comes into the data portal. Okay, great. So we've got those resources down here. Take a look. So, Freshwater Plants in Cameroon. You can see how many records it has, 1,000 records. How many have georeferencing, a description of the resource, and contacts associated with the resource. So, this is ultimately what I'm talking about when I'm talking about registering your data. You're going to register it with GDIF in our registry. And then we are going to come and we're going to index your information so that it's publicly accessible and searchable in the data portal. this down here, coming back to this diagram. That's the registry. So don't worry, you get these presentations eventually with all the links, so you can refer back. You don't need to worry about even that. So what kind of resources do we have in the world? We've got our archives coming from IPT, we've got others that aren't necessarily in IPT, and we've got those tools from the past, such as Javier Otegui and Braak that are also published in the biodiversity dataset. Now, how do you register in the dataset? Well, the easiest way is to use that spreadsheet, create your Dalmcor archive, and then send the very helpful people at Gmail an email. And so I would use the instructions here on this slide. I would say, okay, Gmail, helpdesk@gmail.org. I've got a new data set. There's a title, description, technical contact, administrative contact, the name of my institution, the institution that owns the data set, which network your institution is a part of. So if you're an institution in Cameroon, your network institution would be GBIF Cameroon, for example. And assuming that everything is already publicly available online, would include the URL to your resource and the document, the metadata document that was registered, etc. Now the IPT, when it's set up, you register it against an organization. And administrators will get to see this page in IPT. You guys don't get to see it because you're not administrators. But every resource in the IPT, when it's being registered, it's registered to an organization. That organization is shown as owning the data set. Just like this morning when I registered a data set against the Danish Biodiversity Information Facility. By doing so, I am proclaiming that the Danish Biodiversity Information Facility owns this data set that I published. New organizations can be added into an IPT, and the registry is also, it's not just a registry of data sets, it's also a registry of organizations. And so every organization that publishes a biodiversity data set is also registered in there too. And it must be registered in there before you can publish. So let me show you what I'm talking about. It's not registered. Okay. Down here is the list of organizations that we have to choose from. This list is set by an administrator of the IPT. So maybe my IPT is configured to publish the Danish Biodiversity Information Facility. And I want them to be the owner of Priscilla's desk. Again, this is just a demonstration. In reality, it would be Priscilla's organization that would own the data set. And to complete this step, all I need to do is press register and confirm that I've let the data sharing agreement. And there you go. So, if I navigate back to my registry, and everything in IPD.gov.org goes into the test registry. So basically, it looks the same. There it is. There's her data set in the global registry. Isn't that amazing? And eventually, this will get indexed and it will appear in the data pool as well. So that's the process. if we go back to the presentation, see the stack here? So it goes to the registry, and once it's in the registry, it's globally discoverable, and then it goes into the database. Okay? So, fire. If you, all I will say is that if your organization doesn't exist in the registry yet, and you're wanting to publish data, then just email helpdesk@gpf.org, and we will make sure that your organization gets created and endorsed. So, what type of resources can you register? Well, you can register metadata-only resources, taxonomic data, recurrence data, the same pictures I've been showing you all day, and I will skip these. Now, you don't need to set this up yourself. If you're just a single researcher, you can make use of an IPT in Denmark that are willing to host data sets. Museums, they might like to have their own IPT because they have many researchers and many data sets they want to publish. Similar situation for nodes or thematic networks. So in this diagram here, you can see that the University of Kansas Biodiversity Research Center has an IPT. And that IPT is serving a resource. But just because the University of Kansas is serving the resource for some of the, is serving this UAFMC fish resource, it doesn't necessarily mean that they own it. In fact, they're just doing a favor to the University of Arkansas Collection Facility, UAFMC. So the University of Arkansas is actually shown as owning the resource. So in this example, if Priscilla wanted to host, to have Denmark host her data set for her, because Denmark could guarantee that they could maintain an IPT and keep her data set online, then Priscilla and her organization would still get ownership credit. It would never appear that Denmark owns her data set. That would never happen. But it would show that Denmark is helping host or serve her data set. Because in a lot of countries, there are internet connectivity issues. And ideally, in a perfect scenario, biodiversity information is accessible online 100% of the time. So when I come to the registry and I try and look for a data set, it's never offline, it's always online. But of course, that's an idealistic scenario, it's not always possible. So where there are internet connection problems, where you can't make a guarantee to the community that you can keep your data sets or your IPT online all the time, it's useful to use hosting centers such as the one that is offered by Denmark. And tomorrow, when we're working together during open office hours, Denmark has told me that it's okay to allow some of you guys to have your data sets there. And so if you're interested, we'll create an account for you, this time for real, on the Danish IPT. So the one that we're using today, IPT.gpf.org, this is just for testing. And you'll notice that by the giant brand at the top, it says test version. But we can do this all for real tomorrow, if you want. We can get your data sets published and registered live tomorrow, at the very least in metadata only format. And we don't have access to Dropbox, but there's a really cool video that Michael from GPF France has put up online. And does anybody use Dropbox?
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. So a dozen people in the room, that's great. So you know what we did today? We created that checklist using the processor, and I gave you that zip file. If you put that zip file in your public folder in Dropbox, boom, you've just published. And you just need to let help desk or GDPR know where it is.